Thank you. Thank you for bringing all these fathers and grandfathers and pillars of strength into our presence this morning.
Yeah.
Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Thank you for our awesome pastor, Pastor John Deron Johnson.
Yeah.
And just continue to watch over our First Lady, Sister Kim, as she journeys, you know, through the various countries in which she will be traveling through. Continue to watch over Ryan and the rest of the family, the twins.
Yes.
Heavenly Father, at this time, we humbly come to you again in the need of prayer. Heavenly Father, there's been a lot of tragedy that's recently gone. But like the songwriter says, Heavenly Father, we know you're able. You're able to comfort those that need comforting this morning. You're able to walk each and every one of us through whatever trial or tribulation that we find ourselves going through at this present moment. Heavenly Father, you know what our needs are. Thank you for your glory and your mercy. Heavenly Father, just continue to bless our sick and our shut-in, and also those that want to be here in our presence with you, Heavenly Father.
Thank you. by Trevor Gorge Jr. Let's give him a hand as he comes.
Holy God, who we call Father, we give you thanks for the people who have been our earthly fathers in this life. And we pray for all sorts and conditions of fathers. For fathers who have striven to balance the demands of work, marriage, and children with an honest awareness of both joy and sacrifice. For fathers who, lacking a good model, have worked to become a good father. For father who by their own account were not always there for their children, but who continue to offer those children now grown their love and support. For fathers who have been wanted by the neglect and hostility of their children. For fathers who, despite divorce, have remained in their children's lives. For fathers whose children are adopted, and whose love and support has offered healing. For fathers who, as stepfathers, freely choose the obligation of fatherhood and earn their stepchildren's love and respect. For fathers who have lost a children to death and continue to hold the children in their heart. For those men who have no children but cherish their next generation as if they were their own. For those men who have fathered us in their role as mentors and guides. For those men who are about to become fathers, may they openly delight in their children. And for those fathers who have died but live on in our memory in the communion of your saints, whose love continues to nurture us. All this we ask in the name of your beloved Son, who is both Father and mother to us all. Amen.
Continue to make your perfect will known to us. cause us to be yielded vessels to you. And God, how you choose to bless the moments that we share, we'll be ever so careful to give you all the glory, the honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God. We want to say happy Father's Day to all of our fathers, and we celebrate our fathers who are here with us and those who are now rest with the Lord. We want to lift up a portion of scripture to you today and move through that portion of scripture, and we'll be ready to go. Let's turn to the book of Exodus, chapter 21. Exodus, chapter 21. And I just want to lift up two select verses that will assist us in unpacking our theme and our focus for today. Exodus chapter 21. If you found it, why don't you say amen?
Amen.
That means you're in the right neighborhood. Let's look at these two verses, verse 15 and verse 17. Exodus chapter 21, verse 15 and verse 17. You found it? Why don't you say amen?
Amen.
And he who strikes his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. Verse 17. And he who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. The death and the devastation that we see plaguing our world, perhaps it could be the result of disrespect and dishonor that has consumed our society. So if you don't get anything else from us today, in spite of how you feel or what you think about Father or Daddy, the Word of God says that when we dishonor, when we curse, when we strike, we bring death to our community. Now, this 21st chapter in these two verses are bracketed by Exodus chapter 20. Don't close your Bible. And look at verse 12. Because Moses gave this mandate when he gave the commandments. Exodus 20 and verse 12. Honor. Are y'all with me?
Yeah.
Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the earth which the Lord your God is giving you. This is the first commandment with a promise attached to it, which says to us to live in peace. The faith community needs to respect authority and build strong families. And so, beloveds, you don't have to be a rocket scientist. If we are not respecting authority and if we are not building strong families, we already know why we have deal with it. But sometimes we bring death and destruction on ourselves. I don't care how much they tell you Papa was a rolling stone. The word of God says, honor the source of life. When we look at honoring the source of life, we got to recognize that sometimes in our society, we make two mistakes. Let me share them with you. The first mistake we make is that sometimes we want to deify our mamas and our daddies and put them on pedestals. There's a difference between honoring and worshiping. I'll say it again. I said there's a difference between honoring and worshiping. And then we need to also recognize that in the midst of the whole grand scheme of things, sometimes we miss the best role models of father because they're right in front of us. You know, I'm just meddling with you. Come on. You know, folk have been just devastated. Black folk in particular. Because Bill Cosby, he was labeled as the prototype for the African American father. And what we have lately come to discover is that even the best image can be marred in just a matter of seconds. And so we got to learn how to recognize that we have all been made in the image and the likeness of God, which requires that we respect one another and love one another, but in no instance are we to worship one another. Our church and our society is at a point where we see all kinds of injustices and violence running amok in our land, and we are no longer disturbed by anything. We're no longer disturbed by guns and violence. Now, simply we ask, how old was the child when he got shot? What color was the child? Rape and illicit dope and crime continues to plague our community, and with blind arrogance, we affirm, we don't make no guns, we ain't got no, we ain't doing no dope, we ain't shipping the dope in. But when we dishonor those whom God has placed in our lives to impart wisdom, to mold and shape us, then we are buying in to the hype. We are making statements that we have a distorted image of what the promises of God really are. We want to argue cases concerning this world, but we already know that as a result of broken covenant, the world is in a bad fix. Gasoline prices on the rise. The rich are getting richer, the poor getting poorer. Y'all know the litany. It saddens us to know that people have misdiagnosed the problem. All of our problems in the community ain't the white man's fault. All of our problems in the community is not because of the Republicans. All of the problems that we see facing the community has very little to do with sometimes what we would say finances and economics. It goes back to the very foundations and basics of just being anchored in the Lord. Anchored in faith. You know, we tend to think that if we just create more laws, if we get get more social programs. It will help deliver people from all of this chaos and nonsense. If we could just get the fatherhood initiative, it will redirect the deadbeat dads. Thus and so. For those who sell drugs, if we would just give them harsher sentences, and then we could perhaps bring the market under control. But in an effort, beloveds, to correct a spiritual problem, we have created a society and culture that is entangled in what I call a legal crisis. We are poisoning and destroying ourselves with legalism. And we need to recognize that the law could teach us, but it can't save us. I said again. I said the law, it can teach us, but it can't save us. The law can mandate that you quit drinking, but it can't make you quit being the person that needs the law to make you quit. I don't think you caught me. I said the law can require and say stop drinking. But the law can't make you quit being the kind of person that needs the law to make you quit.
Come on now, say it.
When we fail to do and be what God has called us to be as a person or people of faith, we are engaged in a legal crisis. Because when we walk down the aisle, gave God our heart, the preacher our hand, or even profess to be Christians or call ourselves children of God, that comes with responsibility and accountability. You gotta live the life that you profess, sing about, and talk about. Some of us, we have too much of the world in us. And because we have too much of the world in us, we can't even begin to make up our minds. Because on one side, we're being pulled by evil. The other side, we're being pulled by that which is good. And so everything we are is out of tune because we are straddled the fence. We're living in ambiguity, living in betwixt, and in tune with the world puts you out of tune with God. And God, through his word, has said it's important to be in the world, but not of the world. And this mandate is a difficult one. It was difficult for the people in our text, and we see that even today it's a challenge trying to live for God. And you got all kinds of distractions all around. I said it's difficult trying to live for God. And you got distractions all around. These recently set free people who have been in bondage, they were flirting with the world. But Moses was telling them that it's time to straighten up. It's time to turn everything over to God. Earlier, Moses had gave them the commandments from Mount Sinai. Again, Moses instructs and says that in order to have law and order, the children of the covenant must learn that you just can't live any kind of way. And Moses was simply saying to the children of Israel, these are God's requirements. God never intended for us to live in chaotic anarchy. That's just a fancy way of saying God never intended for us to just live and do what we want to do when buy into frame of mind of thinking, it's your thing. Do what you're gonna do. It's my pride. And the litany, the rhetoric goes on. But here in this lesson, God is saying to the children of Israel, even in the midst of slavery and in bondage, we've got to recognize that God's will for us is not that any man should perish, but that we might have life and have it to the fullest. So let me lift up to you why we need to be honoring our fathers, why we need to make sure that we don't fall in the traps of cursing and striking. Because God requires through His Word that we are to give one another a helping hand. Yes. Stop using our strength against one another. Yes. That means that when God has blessed us to achieve or to mature and to grow, those strengths and those benefits are not to be used to take advantage of our fellow men, but rather we ought to use the strengths, the skills, and the abilities that God has given us to help one another, to encourage one another, to lift one another up, rather than to push them down. Stop being so jealous and envious of one another. We got to recognize that we're all in this together. We all need each other. And we must accept responsibility to set our brothers and sisters free. We have been given the resources, the opportunity to extend forgiveness, love, and understanding toward one another. Why, in the name of God, would you still go through life holding a grudge against somebody, being angry because this didn't happen, or because that? You need to recognize that if God has blessed you and allowed your golden moments to rule, move on, you ought to be shouting and giving God the praise and recognizing that had it not been for the Lord on your side, you don't know where you would be. But because of His grace, because of His mercy, you have not been consumed. Why don't you recognize that in times like these, I've been wounded, but you still have life. Blood is pretty warm in your veins. You still have a reasonable portion of health and strength. That means that we've got to learn how to have some services of healing and deliverance. Services of healing and deliverance means that we got to get over these pains. We got to get over these bumps and bruises, because until we get over the bumps and the bruises, we'll never be able to walk like God wants us to walk, and talk like God wants us to talk, and to live and to serve like God wants us to serve. Moses points it out in this word, if you have it close your Bibles. Moses alludes to the concern for personal injury in verses 12, chapter 21. He says, he who strikes a man so that he dies shall surely be put to death. So he's saying to us that if you got to take matters into your own hand, you are not the source of life. And because we are not the source of life, then we have no authority to take a life. Did you hear me?
Yes.
If a man acts with premeditation against his neighbor to kill by treachery, you shall take him from my altar that he may die. We're seeing the results and all of the consequences of unchecked behavior in our society. We're seeing. You people don't know, I wonder why this is happening. Listen to a lady on the radio the other day. She's talking about family's cursed. No, your family is just disobedient. Your family is not cursed. But when you fail to do what God says to do, she's just going on. Well, you see, my brother, he got shot. And then my daddy, he had a heart attack. And my auntie. Now, what does that got to do with you saying that you're a Christian and you sitting up there on the radio calling in when you ought to have... when she ought to be in somebody's... Y'all got me. God says in his word that when you sow seeds of violence, you will reap violence. Violence diminishes the person and it destroys community. We've got to teach our children, we got to teach one another to value life,
yes.
To value life goods. Life goods have to do with dignity and respect. Most of the time in our community, we still have to grapple with the words of Marvin Gaye. What's going on? Far too many are crying. Far too many are dying. Ask folks where they're going. They don't know. And that's because we haven't taken the time to get in God's word, to let our children, and to remind ourselves that when we avoid and when we misuse, misappropriate, dishonor the word of God, it brings about death and destruction. If we are to have life, and if we are to celebrate and appreciate life all around us, as a community, we must learn how to enforce discipline without being vengeful or vindictive. I'm walking through the text here. Round about verse 18 and following. It was simply saying here that if men contend with one another, decide that they want to fight one another, only thing that they're doing is bringing about death and destruction. We must lift up a standard of discipline, not being vindictive. But we must understand that we live in a violent society, a society that is ripped and torn by tragedy, by anger and bitterness, by poverty and oppression. The legal recourse has been given. There are penalties in place to curb the violence. And many of us think that we can just do things and get away with it just because nobody has said anything to us. Just because we think nobody saw us. We may think that we're getting away with it. But I stop by to let you know that the reason we're living in fear and running and avoiding death is because we have failed to understand that God says that there are some consequences when we fail walking around carrying baggage from the past. Are you listening to me? It was not God's purpose. But the psalmist says, it was good for me that I was afflicted. He didn't say it was good to me. He said, but it was good for me. And you got to recognize that some of these experiences are designed to bring out of you what's already in you. But were it not for your troubles and your trials, you would know what faith in God could do. I said, don't curse. He old. He don't know what he's talking about. Don't act like I'm just making this up. The greatest expression of faith is to bring honor and to give honor. And I say this and I'll be done. You can give honor even when you don't think they deserve it. Because see, it ain't about you. Nor is it about them. Are y'all listening to me? It's about what God requires of us. If you just don't go around giving honor to whom you think honor, is due. Some of us are so picky, you'll never honor anybody. But see, the word of God is our guide and the script that we follow. And when we go off script, you're going to solve things with your hands. But now I can finally get him. I can finally get him. He's 50 years old, 60 years old. You tell him you're going to put him in a home because they never let you go to private school. I'm gonna make them wait before I fix their dinner. Because I used to have to wait. Y'all see how the enemy can just... Respond to prayer.